without further ado, let me introduce you to Paul Lindley. Paul is an award-winning British entrepreneur. He qualified as a chartered accountant at KPMG. I did too, and I'm an electronic engineer too, by the way. So weird seeing this in other CVs. But I qualified with Pricewaterhouse competitor. Then spent 9 years at children's TV brand Nickelodeon. Amazing. In 2006, he founded Ella's Kitchen, an innovative brand of organic baby food built on a core social mission, which we'll find out about at some point today, because Paul is also speaking on a panel later. Ella's Kitchen is the UK's number one baby food brand with a turnover of more than 100 million euros from across 40 countries. Paul sold the company to the NASDAQ-listed Hain Celestial in 2013 and remains chairman. In 2014, he co-founded the Key is E, serial entrepreneur, obviously, supporting African entrepreneurs whose social business benefit children. In 2015, he founded Paddy's Bathroom, a brand of natural toiletries for children that also creates clean water for children through its drop-by-drop program. And I believe some of the journalists do have a sample of the product for them to try out. So enjoy it with your baby. It's bubble bath. Paul believes the best businesses make profits and have a core purpose to do social good, and is an ambassador for the Family and Childcare Trust, a counsellor at One Young World, and a passionate, effective, and vocal advocate for entrepreneurship, the evolution of capitalism so it better serves all of society and for children's rights. So please may I invite Paul Lindley to the stage.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Chitra. Thank you for inviting us all to your wonderful resort. So I've got 45 minutes. So it's 40 up there. I was told 45. So it's going to go to 45, I'm afraid. Okay. So I'm going to talk about little wins. Now, if you've already looked at the agenda and things, you may be thinking, what is little wins? Is it around little steps we can take that can make big changes in our lives? And you'd be right. Or is it about little wins as in little comma wins, and it's the little people that we should take inspiration from, not the big and the famous people that we can help to develop our lives from? And you'd be right as well. So I'm going to talk about those two things in the context of, I think, most of us in this room who have managed to juggle starting a business and starting a family and growing a family and growing a business and finding all the challenges that both of those things bring. Now, Chitra very kindly introduced me with my sort of adult CV, if you like, but I really wanted to introduce me, the real me. So, just look at me. I don't know what went wrong, but look how happy I was in that photo, in that moment, just enjoying that moment, not knowing really what's coming the rest of my life or the next 10 minutes, forgotten what has happened 10 minutes before. Just in that moment, because I've just learnt how to throw a ball. And I'm brave, and I'm creative, and I'm tenacious, and ambitious, and all of those things. But most of all, I don't care what's going on around in the world. I'm just in that moment. And the way I grew up is not the grey-haired, lined guy that you see here who supported the wrong football team all his life. It is by keeping that little guy inside of me that is the real me, not the facade that you see in front of you. And that's why whenever I hear someone say, Mr. Lindley, I look over my shoulder to find, see if they're talking about my dad, not about me, because I'm still that little boy. But why is he important? Well, he's important because he's the guy that created the business that I founded that grew so fast and is still growing. It was his sort of outlook on life that really has made our business successful. And how, right at the heart of our business, one of the very core values where people are rewarded and employed and promoted is being childlike. That's one of our differentiators. And that's because he is still in with me, and those values are still within the company. So the company that I founded, as Chitra said, is called Ella's Kitchen. That's what we do. We primarily make baby food and toddler food. We make it, it's organic, and in my view, it's the best in the world. But you don't need to take my words. It's far better in this day and age when consumers have the power over businesses to take their words for it. So I've got a tiny clip here of a father with his baby just interacting with our product and says everything that I would love to say about our product, even though it says nothing about the food itself. So let's see if that comes in.
Yeah, we just found something else that makes you laugh. It's not funny. We go, baby stew. It's Ella's kitchen, the beefy stew. You know.
So that goes on for 20 minutes on YouTube. The dad laughs as much as the baby. But that's what you want from a brand. If you want to interact with the consumer, you want your consumer to play back to you that it's fun for the baby, it's healthy for the parents, and that it's just the stress of weaning can be played through in a fun way. So our business is all around trying to stimulate all of the senses of a baby so that everything around feeding, weaning, and food time is fun for them. And that's, I believe, how our business has been successful. But let me first take you on a short story, very short story, of how we got going. And stories are vital, I think, in our world of business, trying to build our businesses, because they're very human. They're what engage us better than facts and figures. And my story really has two parts. At home, I started to have my family, and Ella, from Ella's kitchen, was my first baby. And when she was weaning, as new parents, we just got frightened the fact that she suddenly one day decided she didn't like things that she'd liked before, or wouldn't try new things, wouldn't open her mouth. And perfectly normal when you have a second baby and more. But what I worked out was the way to get her relaxed and giggling was to play silly games and have mess and fun and just be the child like she was. And she'd laugh and I'd open the spoon, open her mouth and she'd put the spoon in. And so I worked out that if food is fun for babies, toddlers, then they'll like it. And if you make that food healthy, from a parent's point of view, they'll still like it. So that's what we set out to do. So, but then in my professional life, I was working at Nickelodeon, as you've heard, and I came across so much information about how in our society, throughout Europe, throughout the world really, our kids are getting less healthy each generation. How a third of them are now overweight, about 20% of them are obese, and it's getting worse. And I could see television was being blamed for that, but I could see that you could make food fun for kids. If you make it healthy and everyone wanted to have it, then that was part of the solution. So that's what I sought to do, to cover sort of being fun and handy and healthy all together. And nobody else sort of really did that. Nobody else targeted the child, if you like, in their marketing and in their sort of positioning. And I just thought, if everyone's targeting the mum effectively, mum and dad, then mum and dad might buy it once, and if the baby spits it out three times, they're not going to buy it again. So really engage the child. So that's what we did. So I started the business very much with those goals in mind, under a mission, which we articulated after a couple of years, but it's what is the heart of our business, and how I think anyone who sets up a business and wants to be an entrepreneur needs a mission that is more than I just doing this to make money. It's your life. You need fun and passion and tenacity within that. And so our mission is all around improving children's lives by developing healthy relationships with food. That's what we do. One of the ways we articulate that is by making products and disrupting the baby food market by changing the packaging and the way it looks and everything, which we're very proud of. But we also make cookbooks. And I know many of you will have had a cookbook in your room yesterday, which actually was published yesterday. That was our fourth cookbook. The first three have sold over 100,000 copies in many different languages. And those cookbooks are all about healthy recipes, but engaging your child in making that food so that they're involved in that process, so that you can bring games into it and can bring fun into the process of cooking. Because like anything in life, if you're involved in the making of something, you're more likely to enjoy it or try it when it's out there. And that's our philosophy with our cookbooks. But we also lobby our government and try and get awareness and behaviour changes about how people bring up their children and their relationship with food. So the four parts of our story, which some of which you've just heard, but we are the biggest baby food brand in the UK and in Ireland and in Norway. And we've got significant presences in Holland and Denmark and Sweden and the US. And I know we're in Spain and I know we're in Portugal. So many countries around the world. In fact, 40 is that number there. So 40% of our revenue is also from outside of the UK. We turn over over 100 million euros, and that grows every year. And we have about 123 products across all sorts of feeding from first weaning through to about 5 years old. So that means, in sort of humanness terms, every half a second of every day, there's someone somewhere around the world having one of our products. So the 40, 45 minutes I'm up here, 5,000 portions of fruit and vegetables will be consumed by babies around the world. And we had a goal from the very beginning of trying to get to 1 billion portions of fruit and vegetables consumed from our products by 2017, the end of this year. And we should do that around about November, December. But I have two children. This is a story so far about Ella. And when Paddy was four, and the business had just started a little bit, he said, do you think they will make a Paddy's Kitchen? And I thought, oh no, what do I do? What have I started? Have no more children, stick it to, and then work it out. And so I started thinking, we've got all of this trust with these consumers. Most people in Britain will use Ella's Kitchen if they've got an under 5-year-old. Most people trust that mission that we've got. They trust the function of the food that we're delivering to them and the goodness that we say is in there. And they trust the mission that we've got and that we're trying to do something and create a business that makes that just goes for society as well as just good for profitability. So I thought about the bathroom and how actually the skin is the biggest organ exposed to all sorts of things in our modern world. And actually, the incidences of eczema have grown and other skin conditions have grown over the last few years, last couple of generations. And that's grown as sort of brands have been putting increasing numbers of SLSs and parabens and different synthetic products in their formulations. And we think that's not right. We can create bubbles in bubble bath. We can create cleaning actions within shampoos and hand washers without having to put those things in. So given that we've got a philosophy and a mission behind Ella's Kitchen, the Paddy's one is very similar in that it's all around increasing hygiene, but making kids feel it is okay and it's encouraged to go outside and get dirty, explore the world. That's what you're there for as a toddler. But to come back and enjoy getting clean too. So And trying to bring a social mission into Paddy's as well. So for every drop of water that a consumer would use in running a bath or using our products, we create a drop of safe, clean water in Africa, in Rwanda or Kenya, for children who otherwise wouldn't have access to that water. So just by buying one of our products, you'll know you're doing something for another part of the world. And our website's full of all the links to the individual families and individual communities which we help, of which 70,000 have had safe clean water over the last couple of years. So I've got a 30-second video here of Paddy's, what Paddy's is. This is out on YouTube. We're amazed at the number of hits this has had already in the first month or two. But this is the kind of feel of what Paddy's is.
I had a little turtle.
And then a tiny tin.
I put him in the bathtub.
She said, he's a
clean. He drank up all the water.
I made a pool of soap.
And now he's sick in bed.
Bubble.
Meet the baby bath range from the daddy who brought you Ella's Kitchen. Paddy's Bathroom. Love a dub dub.
So it's a tiny business, only three of us. I'm going through all the things of how do I balance that with my wife and my family and juggle home and work and the other things that I do, but we'll see whether it's successful or not. But it's based on a mission, it's got quality products that are needed by consumers, and we have the trust of Ella's Kitchen, so we'll see how it does. But both of the businesses that I've created around my children and being a normal family are really built on the same values and child-led, taking the consumer first and seeing what they need and what they want. And when I'm asked, as I am so often these days, about what's the success, why are you successful in your business, and what is the secret, and what advice have you got, my advice is to think like a toddler, ultimately. And that's what I'll spend the rest of our time sort of talking through. Because what that comes away from is that not only can we sort of look down literally on children and try and teach them things. We can learn so much by them looking up to us and taking inspiration. I'm going to give you two or three quick examples of where little big ideas have come from little people. The first was a little girl in the 1960s called Jennifer, and she went on holiday with her parents and they took a load of photos, and she wanted to know why they couldn't see the photos straight away, why they had to wait till they got home, go to the pharmacy and get them developed, which millennials just don't understand, but that's what we used to do. And so her dad was an inventor and a physicist, a guy called Edward Land, and he invented a camera called the Polaroid camera, which by the mid-60s, over half American households have. And in the 70s, over a billion photographs were being taken on Polaroids every year, all because a little girl posed the question why she couldn't see the photograph straight away. About a decade later, it tended to be developed for or used that way. So, okay. So you've just found all these new things because you've just gone on this journey, now you've grown down, over the last couple of years, that is the most amazing journey you'll likely go on in your whole life, because you've gone from being nothing to learning to smile and to walk and to talk and to play, of which you've learned all these fantastic skills that should equip you for the rest of your life. But the bad news is, by the time you get into your 20s and 30s and 40s and 50s, you'll have forgotten or put aside many of those skills that actually saw you become the person that you are. My contention in my book and my learnings from building my business is we want to rediscover them, because we were at our happiest probably when we were a toddler, if nothing else. But we didn't fit in the rules, and we learnt so many skills. So the book talks us through, but I'm just going to quickly go through a number of those skills. First of all, learning to smile. That's the moment where you don't just smile one day. You've looked around and you've absorbed so much and you've thought about it, and then at one point you get brave enough to try and do something with your mouth, and then you respond to the reaction that you get with that. And that's really about being confident and creative. They're skills that we learn then. So hopefully a piece of paper has gone round to everybody just now with some circles on one side. But on the other side, I would like to do 30 seconds only. I would like you to pick up a pen and draw the person next to you. 30 seconds only, and I've got a clock up there. Well, that's the 30 seconds, amazingly. So now show the person that you've just drawn what you've drawn, please. Okay, so what I'm hearing is a lot of laughter, which is good because we're having fun. But the laughter is kind of embarrassed laughter. And I heard a sorry over here. Okay, and that's perfectly normal. However, it's not normal for toddlers, because what a toddler would do, they would draw that picture and they would show it to you. Bang. And you'd say, but you're giving me a big nose. And they would go, yes. And so what they're doing there is being confident, but also being creative. So let's just look at creativity in the context of, confidence in the context of adult life. Because when we're adults, we worry about what people think of us and have inhibitions. And part of that is just developmental in the way physically our brains develop, and in our teenage years we get embarrassed and we get inhibited by the way our brain grows. But part of it is because a society that teaches us to conform. Now, we've all, I think, in the room taken steps to create our own businesses. And that first step, many, many people have ideas of businesses and don't take them. So we're on the more confident side of society, I guess. But we're constantly faced with challenges of making our mind up. And we know that we don't know all the inputs, if you like, all the things that we need to know to make the right decision, if there is such a thing as a right decision ever. But neither do toddlers. And toddlers live in a binary world where everything is kind of black and white. They'll instantly make a decision whether they like you or not, whether they like your food or not, whether they're going to play with the game or not. And they live in the same world, physical world, that we do. Now, obviously, we have complicated things to think about, but not everything is complicated. And my contention is we should go back and get the confidence we had as a toddler sometimes to make decisions, making them simpler, really, and using your instinct, knowing that even if you did have all the information to make the right decision, and I'll argue there isn't a right decision ever, but we don't know the consequences from knowing all of that information. So really getting comfortable and getting confident in the idea that making a decision is better than not making a decision and just going with it and being a hard step. Because in our businesses, if we don't believe in our businesses, nobody else will. So that's confidence. Creativity is aligned with that. And that's almost like you've taken that first step and now you want to travel on the path less traveled because we're trying to do things that other people haven't done. And creativity isn't really about big blue sky moments. It's about challenging conventions. And you challenge conventions by asking questions and questioning the answers that you're given. And that might be just a question of, why do we have this meeting? Why do we have this machine? And really, creativity allows you to try different strategies, as toddlers do all the time, and play, iterate, and find solutions by failure, and then acting on that failure and improving, so prototyping things in business speak, and moving on from there. Another fabulous story I came across was of another four-year-old girl who, on her very first day at school, sat down and the teacher said to the class, draw somebody you love as the very first thing. So they all scribbled away. And the teacher came up to this little girl and said, what have you got there? And the little girl said, that's God. And the teacher said, wow, but nobody knows what God looks like. And the little girl didn't even think about it. She just said, well, they do now. And that confidence and that... None of us can say that little girl's picture was wrong. God doesn't look like that. So using creativity and confidence together in our adult life, because we once all thought like that, is part of the solution, I think, to improving our lives. So let's think about learning to walk, which was an incredible journey, perhaps the most incredible, because we fell over 500 or 600 times. Every one of us who has walked into this room today fell over, cut our knees, cried, bruised our lips, cried, yet we all walked. We all walked by having a determination and an ambition that was beyond what we could physically do. So setting ourselves big goals and diving right in is the ambition that I think we can take inspiration of from when we were children. I'm the sort of person, and I think most entrepreneurs are, where I like to set really high goals. And I don't care if I hit here and there's a gap and I failed, because I know I will learn from failing. Because a bigger worry for me is that I achieved here, but if my goal was down here and I overachieved it, I wouldn't have got here, I'd have got down here somewhere. And therefore, aiming high, learning, trusting others to help us, and adapting are core things that we can learn by keeping exploring and keeping getting up and having that ambition to do something that is, it seems impossible. And of course, the close ally of ambition is determination. That idea, we all know put the word stubborn up there. Those of us that still have toddlers will see this every day. But if you think about it in the context of you were once a toddler and you were once the stubborn person that your child at 2 or 3 may be now, and their determination to get the iPad off the table or get to the cake or whatever is second to none. And their determination to get up when they fall over and get back up again and to stand their ground are really valuable to us when we're in a commercial negotiation. When we're being beaten up by somebody perhaps more powerful in this negotiation, we should stand our ground and move on. So I think determination is absolutely key, and grit in that determination is a key part of it. But we live in a world where, for millennials, everything comes so easy and so quickly. If you want to start a business and research something, you go on Google and it's there. If you want to buy something, Amazon will deliver it tomorrow. If you want to watch a TV program, you just go on Netflix. You don't even have to wait for the television schedule to come out in the cinema. Even if you want to date, you just swipe right for this generation. Yet, when they work for us, or they set up their own business, or they start a family, not everything is going to be immediate. And actually, the true things that we value in life, like job satisfaction and relationships, personal relationships, take years to develop. And so, encouraging that generation, our children in the next few years, to have that grit and determination and ambition to aim high and keep going when things falling over is perhaps a bigger challenge for that generation than it was for other generations before. Okay, the most seminal moment, I think, for parents is when their babies say their first word. We all remember what they were. For my Ella, bizarrely all about food. More was the first one. Pick, which was milk, and Boshtik, which was breakfast, came out, and we were amazed. And then with Paddy, it was Ella, his hero, and Eddie O, which we worked out was ready, steady, go. But I'm sure you've all got your own words, and it's a seminal moment. And when they start talking, they start exhibiting their own personality and their own views on the world much more easily, and it becomes much more of a two-way conversation. Now, when they first start talking, toddlers are honest. They don't know how to lie yet. Lying is a physiological development that happens around about two. It's a positive thing, as in we've worked out that we might be able to get away with it. But we don't really use it until a little bit later. And honesty sees through. I've got a story, moved through many stories of Paddy was about three, Ella was five, and we got a birthday cake for one of them, and we left it in the kitchen, and we came back, and there were finger marks in it, and they claimed they hadn't had it, but there was chocolate around both of their faces. And one of them said, "I'd had it, Paddy," and Ella said, no, it wasn't me. And he was like, "Yes, you did." And he came out of the story a lot better, let me tell you. Because truth brings trust. And we can think of that and all the inappropriate things our toddlers have said that have embarrassed us in public, and even worse when they said, "But Daddy, you said that." But in a world in business where you've got Volkswagen breaking rules and thinking they can get away with it, or you've got the Panama Papers coming out when people think that they've got secrets, there are no more secrets. So building a business on transparency and authenticity and being honest is absolutely vital. A little story I've got in my book, which I'll very quickly run over now, is last year I had the privilege of meeting Mr. de Klerk, President de Klerk from South Africa, and he told me about the conversations that they had running up to the new constitution in South Africa in 1994, and how two sides who were physically at war with each other, and there was, or had been, and there was still violence in the communities, and two negotiating teams who really didn't like each other, but had this higher goal of knowing that they had to create something together, worked. And many, many times, he said, the negotiating teams just walked away from the table. And him and Mr. Mandela had to pick up the phone to each other and effectively expose their weak position to each other in the view that the other one would appreciate that and appreciate the higher goal, and they could get something together. And they formed a friendship over that, even though they were poles apart politically. And because they had honest, difficult conversations, and we know we can have them with the team that we have, and it's better to address something that might fester otherwise and become a lot worse by having an honest conversation like a toddler would at an early stage. And if you don't believe me, we'll go to millennials again. This is a lady called Jessie J, famous British pop star. And what she says to millennials and young people is far more important than what people like I do. And what her generation is about is the first four lines of her most famous song, Price Tag, which I think, if we just think in the context of our business, is an incredible thing for a young pop star to sing. And this is what she says. So the person at Volkswagen who thought it was okay on the day that they conceived that they'd fix all the emissions probably told his children that morning to be good at school and probably phoned his mum that evening to check she was okay or help the old lady across the road that lived next to him, yet felt it was okay to lie and break the law and deceive all of their trusted consumers. And that is just not going to happen in the future. So in building your businesses, think like a toddler, but think like how the millennial generation who are buying from us and working with us will expect. Now, toddlers, if nothing else, get noticed. If you put one on stage now, you'd ignore me completely. And some of them put up their hands when they get a lot older, but most of them will have a tantrum or have big giggle, infectious giggle or something. Now, I don't condone tantrums in any way, but they are a strategy that they use to get attention. And as small businesses, we need to get noticed. And there is a cacophony of noise out there that is really difficult. But telling your own personal story and working out ways that you can nibble at people's attention by relevant and simple And emotional messages are the ways that our businesses can get through, as we think, as we can learn, not from our toddlers, but from ourselves, the very same people that are trying to do something in business now. And showing our feelings as well. Business is often thought of, you've got to have a poker face and really be professional and about it. Now, I don't think professional is the right word at all. You should be having fun at work. You're at work more times than you're with your family or with your friends. And actually, as entrepreneurs, our work is our life. And if we're doing it and we don't enjoy it, we should frankly not do it. But we should make things personal. Show what passion we've got for what we're doing. And we encourage that passion that drips down into our team. And we need to be empathetic, to understand what others feel about us and how our impact in our management style or what we say about our product to our consumers is has on them, and really understand that. And above all, be purposeful. It goes back to having a mission in your business. You can convert the idea of showing your feelings into corporate speak by saying, have a purpose for your business that you can be really proud to tell everybody and be passionate about and get people trusting and believing in what you're saying. I've got a little video here, 20 seconds, of what I mean about showing your feelings. This little girl is seeing something she's never, ever seen before. We see it every day. We saw it yesterday, certainly. And watch her face and how she shows her feelings, but also watch the dad's face about his reaction. And I'd love him to be able to do that in his work setting as well. And the wonder what they see.
More? You want more rain? Okay, one more time. Here we go.
So why don't we look at rain in that way now? Next time we see rain, now we're still all grown down. Just listen to the sound of it on the window pane, or the colour of the clouds around it, and just notice something that you don't notice on your day-to-day thing, because it might break up your routine, and your routine might allow you to think about something in your business in a new way that might be that little bit of creativity that actually changes, little win that makes a big change in your life. And the dad is in the moment there as well. He's appreciating rain because his daughter is. Okay, a thing we can do on the way home, perhaps, around stories and around communicating, is six words. Now, again, we live in this world where everything is so pressurized and instant, there's this cacophony of noise, and we need to get ourselves heard. So tweeting and really putting essence of what you're trying to do about your business into a short elevator pitch is vital. And a technique I've used is a six-word idea. So stories need a beginning, a middle, and an end. And the shortest way people have found to do that is in six words. People can tell a whole story in six words. The most famous one is by Ernest Hemingway, who used those six words for his story. I'm sure you'll agree we can all envisage that there are many more words behind why that's going on. We all may be thinking of different things, but there's a story there. There's a beginning, a middle, and an end. And we can think about our personal lives or our business lives in six words. And I think it's a fantastic exercise because it helps you cut to what the heart of your business is. Here's mine from what I see my life. But it's something on the plane on the way home, perhaps, you can just have a little think about. So I'm not going to say too much about this little clip here now, except that it's fantastic. But let's just think how these people are connecting with each other and what we can learn about our business about the way they do that.
This is like being a secret agent.
How old are you?
105. I'm going to help you today.
Okay. Hey, to the guy with the grey hair. Say hi.
Hi, hello.
My name is Victoria.
Hi, my name's Victoria.
You look as old as my grandma.
But you look as old as my grandma, actually.
Oh, that's nice.
Are you going to die soon?
Are you going to die soon?
Well, I don't.
Well, I hope you don't.
I hope you don't.
Because you're really nice.
You're really nice.
Hi, mate.
Hi, mate.
What are you doing today?
What are you up to today?
Chris?
Yeah?
Talk to the girl in the stripy shirt.
Right, can I sit down?
Can I tell you a story?
Can I tell you a story?
Yeah.
Once upon a time...
Once upon a time...
There was a goldfish.
There was a goldfish.
He was all alone.
And he was all alone?
The end.
The end.
unusual.
My hair.
I like your hair.
Yeah. Do you want to talk about fairies?
About fairies?
Yeah.
Sit closer.
Do you want to come and visit my house?
Do you want to come around my house?
Are you kidding me?
No.
Do you want to go? Like now? Or... Yeah?
Can I have a cuddle?
Please, can I have a cuddle? Come on.
Here you play patty cake.
Are we friends now?
Are we friends now?
You are very interesting.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Borderline psychotic, but I'm
keep well around.
Shall we learn each other's numbers?
So we can call each other, maybe.
5555.
5555.
That's less numbers now.
Yeah,
that's 5.
Shall we be friends?
Oh, I'm your hand so big and lovely.
Okay, we were those people once, okay? And although we've laughed, they connected with each other, and they... Why can't we do that in business? Why can't we form relationships like that in business, and probably with our families when things get tough as well? So taking inspiration from seeing children like that and remembering that that was once ours, we can simplify our world and bring more happiness, but also actually get changes done by getting people dancing and things. Okay, the final thing really is around learning to play, which actually I think is the most important, and is certainly one of the ways Ella's Kitchen has been really successful, because play and being childlike is right at the heart of our business. And many of us think play is a thing for children. And I'd argue that actually you'd think twice about saying that learning was for children. We need to all to learn through our lives. And there's so much evidence to show that play-deprived adults are less energetic, less happy with their lives, more stressed, and many things like that. And there's this huge paradox. In the dictionary, you Google play, and it will tell you that it's an activity you undertake for entertainment or enjoyment for no ulterior purpose. Yet the skills that we learn when we play are incredible. And whether that's spatial awareness, it's how we relate to each other, it's how we solve problems, it's how we work out that maybe one more than one solution to something, and tests our creativity. So we need to play more in life. And when we were toddlers, we just played for a living. That's what we did. That's all we did. And that's where we learnt to enjoy a journey. Now, if we've chosen to create our own jobs and be entrepreneurs ourselves, we really want to enjoy the journey and not at the goal that we're trying to get to, because we shouldn't be doing it otherwise. And we can enjoy that journey by having fun, and play is part of that fun. Because play allows you to mix it up and prototype and pretotype and get things wrong and not be afraid of failure and then work things out. And it allows you to create the space. Now, Winston Churchill once said that when we build buildings, we create the space, but thereafter, the space creates us. And that's absolutely true, and why culture and environment is so critical in the workplace. And if you think about it in children's terms again, when we have a new baby or a toddler, we put so much effort into their first room and their playroom and how it all looks nice. And I think we should be doing exactly the same thing with our team to encourage them to enjoy being at work. And what toddlers do, how they get to play, is role play and play with others. And by doing that, they're involving people in teamwork. And that is the single most thing why Ella's Kitchen is successful. We've got a team that's motivated for their job because they know there's a higher mission and they enjoy being at work. And when we involve others, we have helping hands and we find other sort of directions to the problem that we wouldn't do individually. And we can get to that 1 + 1 = 3, and we can have these amazing chance discoveries. This is why something like this is so fantastic, because you'll meet people that you would never have otherwise met if Chitra hadn't brought us all together. And there may be something that comes from this. I have got a fantastic friend who was a child soldier and is now a hip-hop artist, who we think exactly the same. We started the Key Z charity together. Yet we should never have met, and when we met, we should never have had anything in common, probably. Yet we do. So, just wrapping up, are we still growing down? Are we still thinking those amazing thoughts that we all once had? And I'm going to put you to the test around that, because you've all got 30 circles on a piece of paper in front of you. And I'm going to give you 1 minute to fill them out. And I'm just going to give you one very simple instruction. I want you to change those circles to something else. Change all of the circles to something else in 1 minute. Okay? Go for it.
you away.
Thank you. I love you. Okay, this is a test done at Stanford in the 1960s by a guy called Bob McKim, and it's been tested on thousands and thousands of different sort of focus groups over the last 40 or 50 years. And the real test is 2 minutes, so we've only got a minute now, so if you've done half of them, I'll probably do it. So if we stop now. Now, what this test does is a test of two things. Who's done all 30? One person. Fabulous. Can you show it? Can you just show us? Wow, 30 individual circles. Brilliant. Because many people do 30, but they create a big picture. Like that. So some of us think, do all 30. His only request was to do all 30. And they do it in one sort of thought stream. One big picture. And you get people doing that. Someone else did Lego. Some others of us have a... Do, make them all different... but have a same thought stream, faces, 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 as many faces as we can do. And some of you may have done that. Some other of us sort of do random things and get stuck and lost. There's one over here, which I'm very disturbed about the bikini. But some of us, and this was my son, this one, use the circle just as a frame and draw things within the frame, which is perfectly within what I ask people to do. So, we'll all have done different things, we can talk about them over coffee or whatever, but the thought I'd like to leave you with is that we've all done them differently. And if you're the person who tried to do one big picture, well, maybe there's a way of kind of slowing down and trying to broaden your mind about other things that you can do. And if you did many different things but didn't get all 30 done, of which I asked you to do, maybe, you know, detail, less detail and more... More speed is something to think through. So perhaps it's time to grow back up, because I'm coming right to the end of my time now, and we need to put our professional suits and things on again. Or maybe it isn't. Maybe for the rest of today and on the way home, and maybe for the rest of your life, so you can take just a minute out of your day every day and think as you once did to get your confidence and creativity and your emotion and your ambition and play and everything like that back into your lives and into your business lives, because that's what will come through. So I'll leave you with one last thing, really, one last thought, and that is, in this world that our children are going to inherit, there is more stress and time pressure than has ever been before. We see that with our businesses. There's more uncertainty about politics and violence and terror and all of those sort of things that we deal with. There's more mental illness coming because we live these lives that are too fast. We already walk 10% faster than we did in the 1990s, 20 years ago. We come across more information in one single day now, we're exposed to that information, than our ancestors did in their entire lives in the 1500s. And that's unsustainable. And my contention is, on top of all of that, we're living longer lives, so we're going to live lives of which we're going to burn out and get stressed too quickly, and our children are going to be even worse so, unless we can take some inspiration from when we were toddlers and look at life a little bit differently and try and find solutions. My political sort of hero is Robert Kennedy, and in the year I was born, when I was a toddler like that picture, he said this in Cape Town. He said, "This world demands the qualities of youth. Not a time of life, but a state of mind, a temper of the will, a quality of the imagination, a predominance of courage over timidity, of the appetite for adventure over the life of ease." Now, if that's not thinking like a toddler, I don't know what is. And in the 1960s, that was relevant, and it's really, really relevant now to not only us and our families and our businesses, but the way we look at society. So I will thank you for listening to me. I will love to enjoy a further conversation on Twitter with that hashtag. Many of you have the book, I think, in your rooms, or we'll have later today. I'd love to know what you think about it. It's not published for 2 weeks yet, so read it and write about it, please. And I just want to leave you showing what some kids thought when they first saw the book.
The little wins.
The huge power of thinking like a toddler. So maybe it's about how children or toddlers think about things.
Pancakes.
And they have a bigger imagination and more ideas than grown-ups.
Yeah, well, adults can learn from toddlers.
No, adults can learn from pancakes.
And how, what toddlers do and what, how imaginative they are compared to adults.
Yeah!
Thank you very much.